This is Johnny the Gangster with Viva Productions, King of Entertainment, one-stop shop for all your entertainment needs. We have DJ service for weddings, corporate, and private events. Throw your guests with Vegas Nights Casino Party, Blackjack, Craps, Roulette, Poker, and more. We also have event photography and limousine service. Call Viva Productions, 206-542-5733, or find us at viva-productions.com. A little less conversation, a little more action, you got it. Call Johnny the Gangster, I'll make you a deal you can't refuse. Ladies and gentlemen, guys and dolls, cats and chicks, you're listening to Viva ENT, and this is Johnny the Capo, and I'm live on the air here in Seattle, and I'm with my lovely co-host, Miss
Dion Shaw. Hello, everyone.
All right, Dion Shaw, and the best producer in the city, Mr.
Hey, it's Eric CC Ryder. Good afternoon.
Now, do you want to.
And welcome back, Dion. Great to see you.
Do you want to sing CC Ryder, or should it be me, Dion?
I think you should do it.
CC Ryder.
And here I was going to say, I kind of envy the fact that Johnny apparently has his own theme music come on when he says his name. There was that techno music there out of nowhere. I think it was just his phone.
Yeah. I know.
A little behind the scenes here. That was just his phone. But
a little DJ action. Yeah. Sampling.
But now apparently I also get the theme song treatment, so it's pretty cool.
Actually, to tell you the truth, that's a new part of the show. It's going to zip in there just right when we open.
Johnny's techno beat.
Yes.
I like the techno beat, actually.
VIP with Johnny.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Ladies and gentlemen, we're live on the air in Seattle. It's a gorgeous day. Looking out the window off the fifth floor of, what's the name of this, the Newport Towers?
There you go.
I was going to say something else, but I knew it was the Newport Towers. So we're in the Newport Towers here in beautiful Seattle, looking out over the view here. It's gorgeous.
It is. It's stunning.
It's like something out of a movie.
Beautiful, huge clouds. I call it the Windows 95 day. Remember that old screensaver?
Right.
Yeah, I like it.
Yeah.
So if you're listening to our show for the first time, you know that we feature rock and roll. We feature legends of rock and roll. We feature all kinds of stuff about rock and roll in general.
Great raconteurs from the golden age of rock and roll.
Thank you so much, sir. I couldn't have said it better myself. Now, today's guest is going to be Bruce Elrod. And you know, a lot of our listeners that listen to our show every week, they know who Cashbox Magazine is. They know who Billboard Magazine is because they know that we're into rock, we're into chart statistics, we're into rock and roll history and all that type of stuff. And Cashbox was huge. And this gentleman, along with Jerry Osborne, has something to do with resurrecting Cashbox Magazine in 2006. And as a young person, being the rock and roll nut that I was and am still to this day, I'm still a rock and roll nut, a historian. I can tell you all about the Beatles, Presley, the Stones, the whole rock and roll era, as well as Jerry Osborne. But this Cashbox Magazine was the chart weekly statistic for all the records that came out at the time.
Along with Billboard, it was
correct.
Really the Bible for what songs and what albums and what artists were making hits, you know, during the Golden Age.
During the Golden Age, correct. And also, Cashbox was neck-to-neck with Billboard. So if you...
Wow.
Yeah, Billboard was like, it was the Bible. Cashbox was the other Bible.
Wow. Well, that's saying a lot.
Yeah.
Billboard is major.
And still is major. And I suppose Cashbox has a resurrection. And, of course, I haven't kept up with it a lot lately. But Our guest today will tell us all about it.
We'll get all the inside scoop from Bruce Elrod.
Yes, and along with the big O, Jerry O.
He's got some charts of his own, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Charts and graphs.
He's another chart nut. So now, I want to talk about, our co-host, Brad Buckles. He's in Hawaii.
Brad.
As usual. And we have wedding expos coming up in January. We have the Tacoma Wedding Expo. We have the Everett Linwood Expo coming up in January. So it's only, you're going to blink your eyes and all of a sudden, boom, we're back to the wedding shows.
That's awesome. Getting everybody prepared for their weddings and in the summer and so on.
Yeah, January awesome. Sounds far off, but when you think about the fact that Thanksgiving is next week, it's not that far off.
Yeah, when you're in the event business like I am and Brad is, the calendar just is like a blur because the next thing you know, right now it's November, mid-November. The next thing you know, it's going to be
January.
It's going to be New Year's Eve. Eve.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, so and then
you're on blink.
And then boom, we're into January. The wedding expo is here, there, and everywhere. So it's something else, that's for sure. So go to brideclub.com, get those dates for the wedding expo. And of course, I want to thank last week's guest that was on our show. And believe it or not, Eric, I know who it was.
Excellent. So your memory, your photogenic memory is working this week.
I had it in my mind about 20 minutes ago.
Well, there's so much going on. I mean,
well,
it's
thank
be,
you
I
so
mean,
much.
The wedding expo and all this fun
all
stuff.
All these corporate parties coming
yeah,
up.
Yeah, I mean, casino parties and the limousine and all of that. I mean, lots of exciting things going on.
Yeah, the DJ and the casino and all kinds of stuff. And, I mean,
I just love that buzz for the holiday season. I just love that. And the Christmas in the air. And I'm just a big marshmallow when it comes to Christmas and holiday stuff.
So if I sing a Christmas song, you'll become a marshmallow?
I will. I'll melt like a s'more, a marshmallow on top of a s'more.
I think you got to sing Winter is a Marshmallow World.
Is that a real song?
Yeah.
Oh, my
that
word.
Was on the Phil Spector Christmas album.
Play it.
Oh.
We'll find that for you. But of course, we want to say a big thanks to Johnny Madera, who was on the show last week. Great guest, great raconteur.
Johnny Madera, last week with all the stuff that he said on the radio about the commissions that artists are getting these days, from Spotify and Rhapsody and Amazon, was very interesting. And
yes, that is an interesting factor.
And
it really is.
This gentleman that's going to be on the show today is probably a fountain of knowledge as far as chart statistics, what artists got. I know Jerry is. It's going to be an interesting show. And as a matter of fact, when we were talking to Johnny last week, it really, 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 really got me excited because I just did all kind of renovation to my personal recording studio and my video studio, and I said, I'm excited. I'm going to get myself up on YouTube and all kinds of stuff. Because basically what he said was artists nowadays don't need the big record company.
That's
with
true.
With YouTube, the social media.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All that stuff.
What say you, Eric?
Yeah, you could really do it yourself. I mean, conversely, the problem with that is there's so many people that are doing it for themselves that it's hard to stand out in the crowd. It really is hard to make a splash, whereas in the old days you had record companies that put some money behind you and put some effort getting the word out about people they thought were special. Now, a lot of talented artists kind of fell by the wayside and didn't get that push because the record company, for whatever reason, thought, well, maybe they're not going to make it, so we'll just put it out there and see what happens. But and then there was a lot of people that could have benefited from some of that push. So, it cuts both ways.
Well, you're absolutely right about that. The big mucky mucks in the record companies and that controlled everything. You know, they kind of controlled life and death as far as being an artist, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And they made a lot of great decisions, and a lot of wonderful artists never made it.
Right.
A lot of great artists struggled for years without, you know, getting the break.
Oh, yeah.
Aretha Franklin, for one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, with this, you can use technology. You can use community outreach, all kinds of ways of getting yourself out there. For example, we have some great artists in our area,
in the
Northwest, just amazing artists that you wouldn't believe. So this gives them another way of getting their stuff out there, which we need. I mean, we always want something new and not canned.
I like it. I like it a lot.
You know, we're about due for our first commercial break.
Let's hear a word from our sponsors, because if it wasn't for our sponsors there, Dion, we wouldn't be on the air.
Yeah? That's right.
Kabish Kalyan.
That's
right.
Kabish.
Everybody stay tuned. More Viva ENT is coming up. Is your vehicle needing some attention? Take it over to Maddie's Tuning and Shoreline for fast, affordable car care. Trusted, professional, Maddie's services all makes and models and has been trusted in the Puget Sound for almost 60 years. Call Brian Maddie at 206-364-3347 or stop by his convenient location in Shoreline right on Aurora at 152nd. Maddie's Tuning. Call 206-364-3347. Trusted for almost 60 years to keep you safe and on the road.
Brides, do you want your big day to be stress-free, perfect, and stay within your budget? Well, Brides Club has all the inside information to make your dream a reality. Go to bridesclub.com. That's bridesclub.com. See upcoming bridal shows and events, view wedding vendors and special offers. And don't miss The Spotlight, the premier online wedding magazine with valuable articles you can't afford to miss. Brides Club helps make your wedding stress-free and perfect. Go to bridesclub.com. Check out bridesclub.com.
Life's a celebration. Grand Event Rentals makes your event their top priority. They are your full-service, special event, and party rental provider, supplying everything you need from start to finish. Their professional sales team and event staff work with you to create your dream event. With every event, Grand Event Rentals customers' needs are the most important. Whether you're planning an intimate outdoor wedding or an elaborate black tie gala, the Grand Event Rentals specialists make great pride in providing our event planning experience to help create an unforgettable event. Please go and visit the Bellevue Showroom, Grand Event Rentals, or make a one-on-one appointment. Talk to them. They're trained, they're knowledgeable, they're event specialists, and they are going to take you through step-by-step everything that you need to make your day a success. Call Grand Event Rentals. Their number is 425-462-7368, or go to grandeventrentalswa.com.
Attention business owners, experience a new world of business with barter. The Saturn Barter Company, located in Tacoma, is one of the most beneficial business decisions you can make. Using Saturn Barter, you are able to sell your products or services to other members of the exchange. You can then use that credit you've built up from your sales to purchase the products or services you or your company needs from other companies within Saturn Barter, all without the use of cash. Contact and join Saturn Barter Club today, 253-212-9930, or online at SaturnBarter.com.
Dr. Amanda Wong and the team at Art of the Smiles provides comprehensive dental services at affordable prices. Their convenient location in Federal Way and their extended hours fits the needs of both families and working professionals. Whether it's transforming your smile through some of their cosmetic therapies or simply having your teeth cleaned, Art of the Smiles provides individualized care plans that address your priorities and needs. Visit artofthesmiles.com or call 253-839-4048. That's 253-839-4048 for same-day scheduling. Most insurances accepted, from cosmetic procedures to implant placement, molar root canals treatment, or wisdom teeth extractions.
There's a reason they invented the internet. It's called 1150kknw.com.
Well,
Ladies and gentlemen, guys and dolls, cats and chicks, we're back. You're listening to Viva ENT. This is Johnny the Capo, your host. We're live in Seattle, and I'm in the studio with my co-host,
Dion Shaw.
Dion Shaw, and the greatest producer in all of the world.
I agree.
Thank you. It's Eric CC Ryder here, and a little marshmallow world, because we were just talking a little bit about it during that first segment on the show.
And that's a Phil Spector production.
Yeah,
right?
Darling Love on the vocals, but you could definitely hear that wall of sound from Phil Spector and his orchestra there, providing the backing track.
You know, every artist, every producer that we've had on the show over the last couple of years have always mentioned Phil Spector. They had something to do with the guy one way or another.
Some didn't like him. Some did like him. And
most of them didn't like him, I'd say.
Well, we know that he's an interesting character.
For
sure.
Yeah. But, well, that comes with creativity. Some of the most creative people are the strangest. I mean, you know, that's just... It comes with the gift. I guess it's the price you pay for being... creative and for being a genius of sorts.
I'll testify to that.
Well, just don't go shooting anyone.
Okay. Unless it's with a water gun.
You don't have to follow the Phil Spector mold that much. Yeah.
See, he should have used a water gun.
There you go.
Or put pudding in it. That's what we used to do when I was a kid.
Pudding.
Pudding.
Yeah. I think he was using the pudding to style his hair.
Like
you saw those courtroom pictures.
Like a pudding pie?
A spiky pudding pie.
Yeah, he was a trippy guy. You know, gosh almighty, if I could have been around in those days in L.A. in the 60s when he was doing all that wonderful production and all those great artists that walked into his studio, the Ronettes, the Shirelles, Sonny and Cher, the Righteous Brothers, Tina Turner, just
Crystals, all that, yeah.
The Crystals.
Yeah.
Yeah, these are amazing artists
and
we're talking about.
And, of course, he produced the Beatles as well.
He produced,
Let It Be, right? That was
I'm not
Phil
sure
Spector,
about that.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. We might want to Google that. I'm not sure about that.
And they weren't entirely happy with his production, so later on released Let It Be Naked, which was like the stripped-down version of it. Yeah, and he went on to produce the Ramones in the either late 70s or early 80s, and the story with that was that he had a gun, and he forced them to put strings on the album.
No
and
way.
The Ramones, punk rock band, were scared of Phil Spector. So I guess that tells you all you need to know.
He was willing to reach the depths of motivation. What is going to get these guys to do this?
Yes.
You know, I dig all that because I know characters like that, you know, back in the day. And a lot of guys used to pull that gun out and... just to give you the shock value. And Phil Spector did it, and he did it a lot throughout his career. And then one night he accidentally pulled that trigger. And I don't even know if it was an accident or not, but, you know, for that fatal situation. But there's no question that he thought it was fun and games, you know, to pull that gun out. And, you know, I got a little bit...
Yeah, it's like a peak in personality or, you know, when you're a genius and you're wild and crazy like that and you're making these weird decisions and doing extreme things, eventually you peak out. You do something just the ultimate thing, you know, and I think that just comes with whatever is going on at the time, too.
Well, you know, the fact of the matter is if you play with a gun, something's going to happen.
Yeah,
you
know, yeah, that's nothing to play with.
There's nothing to play with, correct.
Yeah.
But, you know, he also did a lot of great things. And one album that he did with John Lennon was the Rock and Roll album. Are you familiar with that album?
That was an album he did of cover songs, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was a really good album. As a matter of fact... I was excited when the album came out because, you know, I'm into the old Little Richard stuff, and John Lennon did Stand By Me, Angel Baby.
Mm.
He did Ready Teddy. I think he did Rip It Up on that album.
Channeling his roots, for sure.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah. So when you know, when the Beatles started out and they were working in the clubs in Germany and England and so on and so forth, they were singing all the Little Richard, Elvis, wow. Chuck Berry, and they were even doing the early Motown stuff.
Wow, so that's all the fun music that gets you going. And
yeah, exactly.
Inspires you, makes you want to just get up and dance.
Like, I don't want you, but I need you. Yeah, Beatles did that on the second album, Smokey Robinson.
And that was incredible.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, and yes, indeed.
It's just wonderful when you think about, like, the meaning that songs, you know, when they sing them, when they sing these songs, they have such meaning behind it.
Yeah, the lyrics in those days were, like, really good.
Really good lyrics.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like that.
And today's music, I'm not going to say that it's not good music, but, I mean, excuse me, good lyrics, but I think that... I don't know. What do you say about the modern day lyrics, Eric?
Well,
it means you're a younger cat.
I'd say it's tough to make a generalization about that because you've always got your genius lyricists and you've always got your bottom of the barrel lyricists, and you know they do their own things, you know, and there's a case to be made for both things, and. You know, I don't know. I can't say that there's necessarily been an overall dip because there was some pretty goofy stuff, you know, back in the old days, and there's some pretty goofy stuff now, and there was some profound poetry in the old days, and there's still some profound poetry. Like Leonard Cohen, for instance, is somebody that has spanned the decades, you know, writing genius lyrics, and unfortunately he passed on, so I guess we could say that now there is definitely a dearth of quality, you know, just because of the loss of a titan like Leonard Cohen this week.
He definitely a legend. What do you say about that same comment, Ms. Shaw?
I would say that kind of, you know, piggybacking on what Eric was saying, that you have some profound, awesome music and lyricists. And then some people are making music and they don't really care about what it says. They're more about the music, the beat, the dancing part of it, you know. And if they could, they wouldn't even have a lyric in there or any singing at all. So they're just trying to kind of just have something, but it's really about the music and the motivation that it brings to your ears and the bliss. So we have some of that too. But it seems like everything back in those days was written for some type of meaning, whether it was to get you happy and have you dancing around and, you know, tantalating those endorphins, or whether it was, you know, just to kind of have you in this romantic mood. I mean, there was always some meaning and purpose for the music. So, you know, I'm hoping that we'll get more of that.
I agree with that. That's a good evaluation. Believe me. But you know what bugs me about the new music?
What is that?
These artists, even Drake. I like Drake. Handsome guy, great artist, but they sing like little kids with the auto-tune. What's going on with that? What? Tell me.
It reminds me of like Stevie Wonder. Remember when he first came out with that?
No, I don't.
Yeah, he had that instrument that kind of made him sound, you know, but it was like an accent to a song, right, Eric? It wasn't like the whole song.
Right, right.
And
use a little vocoder to kind of change things up a bit. But yeah, there was a while where it seemed like every hit song was just coded in auto-tune, and it got old real quick.
Well, yeah. am I talking like maybe 3 months ago, or is it still going on now?
You know, I'd say probably less in 2016 than, you know, say 2015, 2014, 2013. Yeah, there was like probably a 5-year span where I would agree with you. It just seemed like it was just all over every song that was on the radio, and it was definitely getting tiresome. Someone even had a song called "The Death of Auto-Tune." It was a rapper whose name is slipping my mind at the moment, but yeah, and they continued to make a lot of auto-tune songs.
A lot of auto-tune.
Even after that song.
So let me ask you this. Am I right when I say that they sound like little kids?
You know, to me, it sounds like a malfunctioning computer, but, you know, it is definitely pitched up more. So, you know, a lot of that lower end that adults have in their voices is not in a recording done with auto-tune. So, yeah, I can see where you're coming from for sure.
It sounds to me like they have this phrase on the words, mm-hmm. and they're purposely trying to sound like kids to appeal to the 9
the younger
to
kids, yeah.
12-year
There's
age
some kids
group.
Bop for you.
Because actually, if you think about it, between 9 and 12 now,
uh-huh.
in my day, 9 and 12, they weren't listening to pop music.
Right.
But they are now.
Huh. Oh, yeah. They're listening to music and they're dancing and everything.
There's another discussion we should probably have at some point on the show. It seems like there's a real dearth of baritone singers out there and people with singing in that lower register, especially now that we've lost people like Johnny Cash and Leonard Cohen. And it is a whole lot of mid-range and high-range folks out there. And being personally someone that enjoyed that lower register in vocals, I think that's kind of a shame. But who knows what the future will hold.
Yeah.
I think we'll be sent someone with an awesome lower voice.
That would be great.
Yeah.
We'll cherish Iggy Pop until then. He's still with us.
Yeah. On the next segment, we have the big O, and of course, Bruce Elrod. Is that correct?
That's right.
All right. You listen to Viva and T, ladies and gentlemen.
Is your vehicle needing some attention? Take it over to Maddie's Tuning and Shoreline for fast, affordable car care. Trusted, professional, Maddie's services all makes and models and has been trusted in the Puget Sound for almost 60 years. Call Brian Maddie at 206-364-3347 or stop by his convenient location in Shoreline right on Aurora at 152nd. Maddie's Tuning. Call 206-364-3347. Trusted for almost 60 years to keep you safe and on the road.
Brides, do you want your big day to be stress-free, perfect, and stay within your budget? Well, Brides Club has all the inside information to make your dream a reality. Go to bridesclub.com. That's bridesclub.com. See upcoming bridal shows and events, view wedding vendors and special offers. And don't miss The Spotlight, the premier online wedding magazine with valuable articles you can't afford to miss. Brides Club helps make your wedding stress-free and perfect. Go to bridesclub.com. Check out bridesclub.com.
Life's a celebration. Grand Event Rentals makes your event their top priority. They are your full-service, special event, and party rental provider, supplying everything you need from start to finish. Their professional sales team and event staff work with you to create your dream event. With every event, Grand Event Rentals customers' needs are the most important. Whether you're planning an intimate outdoor wedding or an elaborate black tie gala, the Grand Event Rentals specialists make great pride in providing our event planning experience to help create an unforgettable event. Please go and visit the Bellevue Showroom, Grand Event Rentals, or make a one-on-one appointment. Talk to them. They're trained, they're knowledgeable, they're event specialists, and they are going to take you through step-by-step everything that you need to make your day a success. Call Grand Event Rentals. Their number is 425-462-7368, or go to grandeventrentalswa.com.
Attention business owners. Experience a new world of business with barter. The Saturn Barter Company, located in Tacoma, is one of the most beneficial business decisions you can make. Using Saturn Barter, you are able to sell your products or services to other members of the exchange. You can then use that credit you've built up from your sales to purchase the products or services you or your company needs from other companies within Saturn Barter, all without the use of cash. Contact and join Saturn Barter Club today, 253-212-9999.
3030 or online at SaturnBarter.com.
Dr. Amanda Wong and the team at Art of the Smiles provides comprehensive dental services at affordable prices. Their convenient location in Federal Way and their extended hours fits the needs of both families and working professionals. Whether it's transforming your smile through some of their cosmetic therapies or simply having your teeth cleaned, Art of the Smiles provides individualized care plans that address your priorities and needs. Visit artofthesmiles.com or call 253-839-4048. That's 253-839-4048 for same-day scheduling. Most insurances accept it, from cosmetic procedures to implant placement, molar root canals treatment, or wisdom teeth extractions.
Working hard to put a smile on your face. Alternative Talk 1150.
Ladies and gentlemen, guys and dolls, cats and chicks, you're listening to Viva ENT. We're live on the air in Seattle. This is Johnny the Capo. I'm your host. I'm here with my co-host,
Dion Shaw,
and my excellent producer, Mr.
It's Eric C.C. Ryder.
My talent coordinator, Mr. The Big O. Jerry Osborne.
Yeah, that's me.
That's you. And we have a special guest today. You know, this guy is right up our alley, Jerry.
Yeah, he's been a friend of mine for probably at least 30, 35 years, okay. Something like that. And we have a lot in common. I mean, we're both crazy about the music of the Golden Age. We're both record collectors. We have both written and published books. We are both involved in Cashbox magazine. And I could go on and on, but let me just say a big howdy hi and welcome to my friend Bruce Elrod down in South Carolina.
Hey, Bruce.
Hello, guys. It's a long ways away from down where you're at. About 3,000 miles, to be exact.
Oh, yeah, cool. But, you know, with this telephone invention, we can cut it real short and make it like we're close together.
That's right.
You know, Bruce, you know, I know all about Cashbox magazine. I don't know, you know, most people that are into music and chart statistics, so on and so forth, know about Cashbox, know about Billboard. Jerry, what did you and Bruce do as far as resurrecting Cashbox? Tell me about it.
Well, okay, but first, what I would like Bruce to summarize is how he came across the opportunity in the first place to do this. In other words, for years, going, I think, 1996, Cashbox folded. You correct me if I'm wrong. And then it was just idle and nothing. So, Bruce, tell us how you came about the opportunity to resurrect it.
Well, you know, it's a great story because in 2003, I used to book Hank Williams Jr. And, of course, Merle Kilgore and Hank and I were talking about old magazines that had gone defunct. And Cashbox came up. And just out of just plain curiosity, we went to GoDaddy and the name was wide open. And we drew straws as to who would get it, and I drew the straw. And I didn't do anything with it for a couple of years. I just kept the domain. And finally, Merle Kilgore, who was dying of cancer, said, I'll never get to see the first cover of the new Cashbox. So in 2006, July 4th, I put up the very first cover of the new Cashbox.
Wow.
And it wasn't nothing but an extension of the old Cashbox. And when I'd done this, I'd done it with the cooperation of Keith Albert and Noel Albert. In fact, they were the two original shareholders with me.
Wow.
So it's still in the family. And we just took it from there. And I never in my wildest dreams would believe that thing would grow to what it is today.
Cool.
I mean, our Quantcast ranking is 32,000 and Billboard 2,000. That's out of a billion websites. So we've just about caught them again. I'm very happy over that. I think within another year or two, we'll be on equal terms again. You know, because we're doing things here they will never do, and they couldn't do even if they wanted to do it.
Well, you have so many charts. You have so many different areas of music covered. And more importantly, you cover some of the smaller areas, those smaller genres that the big boys don't really want to deal with.
That's correct. And, you know, Billboard has their way of doing things. We have our way, and my way is, I think that all 50 states should be represented. and not just about 5 or 6 metro areas. And with a smaller chart, it's, for instance, we created the traditional country outlaw rockabilly chart last November. And that was to give the older country artists a chance to be a hit again. Because if you're over 35, you're not going to make that new country chart. I mean, you're just banned from it. And in 1 year now, we have just about got to the point where this time next year, those two charts are going to be equal. I mean, this new chart up there right now, Gene Watson's in there, Willie Nelson, Merle Haggard, Johnny Cash, Freddie Hart. A lot of the originals have spilled over into that chart. Country Christian, which was a back from Southern Gospel, because Southern Gospel is such a closed-door chart. If you weren't born into the family, you're not going to get in there. So they created Country Christian. It has grown from 20 to 100 positions now.
Wow.
And a lot of that 100 positions are older country artists that just can't make that cut anymore.
You know,
and I had one young man yesterday call me. He was 48, and he just gave me a lecture. He was going to hit Billboard's chart, be right up there at the top. I said, well, it's like this. I mean, Garth Brooks has a new single, and it's not in there. I don't think you're going to go in there. And I said, so take your chance. I mean, you could pay him $500,000. You might get 1 week. That's about it. You know, Billboard does sales, too. We don't do the sales for the radio chart. It's all radio.
Right. But
so that's the difference between the two of us.
What about the streaming thing going on right now?
Well, the streaming thing, we do count streaming and we do count internet radio.
Cool.
And we do see that up there. We have DRT. DRT is our main source of information. That's Digital Radio Tracker. They do the main chart. The 8 or 9 smaller charts that we have separated from that, that's all radio.
Very cool.
And the one thing about radio is, I hate to say this, very few AM stations. Internet radio, I've never believed in, because I don't think anybody can sit in front of a computer 8 to 10 hours a day listening to a damn radio. Hard to put about that, but that's the truth. I mean, anybody that exaggerates that and thinks that people, they've got 100,000 people listening to internet radio unless it's serious and in your car, they're crazy. It don't happen that way.
Crazy.
We want to let people know right now, and we'll remind them again later, that all of this action, all of this is happening at CashboxMagazine.com, correct?
That's right. Everything's at CashboxMagazine.com.
There you go.
And when I did recreate Cashbox, and with Noel and Keith, we obtained the original. We've got the original EIN number, which starts with 43. That's actually how old it is.
I love it.
August.
Wow.
It started in August 1942.
I know that.
Well, I went back and looked at a lot of the old issues in the archives that you have there, and that's just beautiful to see.
Well, you know,
we have everything up there now. You can go all the way back to 1942.
Well, when I was a teenager, Bruce, I would go every week to the magazine stand, and I would pick up the Cashbox magazine and the Billboard magazine too. So I would look at both, and I would compare both, and I would, I would memorize the chart. That day, you know, the top 100, the top 200, everything, you know. So I lived and breathed the charts.
It's just like myself when I was that age.
Right.
Every Saturday, my dad would take me to the newsstand in Columbia, and I'd save up my money. $1.50 would buy me Record World, Cash Box, and Billboard.
Yeah.
And I could have fun with all three of them. And by the way, as time progressed with Cashbox, in 2010 or 11, I went ahead and acquired Record World magazine, too.
Oh, wow.
As a sister magazine to Cashbox. And once you go online, you'll see Record World. Up there, you'll see Cashbox. And I also acquired the rights from American Tobacco for your Hit Parade. I own all three of them.
Wow.
Speaking of your Hit Parade.
Hit Parade, I used to read all the time.
Tell us a little bit about your book, The American Hit Parade.
I wrote the book that's still available at Amazon, Your Hit Parade and American Top 10 Hits, which carries all of your Hit Parade through 1958. And from there, I use Billboard. That's kind of ironic, but that's what I use.
Mm-hmm.
And the book is still available there, and it's gone up in price. I mean, it costs to get one now. And I'm just never going to redo it unless Joel Whitburn decides to take my old one and put it back together, which I've told him he can do if he wants to. And so right now, Joel has just about finished Cashbox and Record World. He's finished Record World. You can actually buy Record World books up there now. And you can buy, I think, four or five of the Cashbox issues are up. Randy Price, if you go to our site online now, you can not only get the pop charts from Cashbox up there, but the country and the R&B now, all the way from the 40s up. Week by week, does it cost you a thing? Then you can go down to the jukebox there and actually listen to all this. We pay SoundScan a good chunk of money every year, but that's free too. You can go to the desktop version, all of the original hits by the original artists. They came out of my record collection.
Anybody that works in record research or has an interest in the music of the past needs to know about these archives. Music Vendor, Record World, Cashbox, you know, there's all these publications, and not only the records and the charts, but all of the news, all the music news, too. I mean, I love finding out about what the legal cases are that are going on, who's suing who, who's been accused of payola, what stars are changing labels. I mean, everything that happened along the way is right there.
That's right. Jim Rose carries everything every disc jockey needs to know 3 days a week. So if you go to Jim Rose Presents Radio up there out of Houston, Texas, you can find out any radio station in the country and what they're up to. And Jerry, we had Carrie meet Mr. Music up there, and I will tell you, there's a lot of folks go up there and read it. Jerry gets me ticked a lot of times because I like to go to bed early. He never puts it up on Sunday when I'm away. So I have to wait till Monday to go up there and read it. But that's some great stuff up there.
Well, I'll tell you a great story about Cashbox that I read, and I was real happy about it. It was 1969, and Elvis had made his big comeback onto the musical scene. And I was a little bit hot about this, and Jerry, you might agree with me. Billboard had Neil Diamond as the number one male artist of the year, but Cashbox had Elvis. And guess what? Elvis should have been the number one on Billboard, too.
Well, you're right. I mean, absolutely right about the whole thing.
I'm right.
Well, you know, I actually have a 63. We use this cover several times up there. It's not up there right now because it got old after a while. But we actually had a photo that we used for our cover. And, Jerry, I know you remember this, of John Lennon reading Cashbox from 1963.
Oh, yeah.
He was holding the Cashbox out, looking at Cashbox. But the Beatles were big fans of Cashbox. We were the first ones to actually chart them in America. It wasn't Billboard. It was Cashbox.
You also had the first photograph of the Beatles, and this was John Lennon on a TV show in England, too. I don't remember the name of the show, but he was one of several acts on the show, and his picture's in Cashbox.
Wow.
Well, that's true. We've got a great cover archive. My God, I've got a file cabinet here full of photos. I don't know what I'll ever do with them. If I'm not around, I don't know who'll get them. But, I mean, I got some classic photos in there. And, you know, I got started myself as a record collector when I was a kid. My uncle was Charlie Walker. And a lot of people don't know that. That's how I got my start, you know, collecting music. Now, this is not the country singer Charlie Walker, but the Charlie Walker that the FCC was the first person to ever be convicted of obscenity on the radio. And the case still stands. If you go to the SEC and type his name, Charlie got in trouble telling jokes on the radio that were very colorful. And back in 1961 and 62, the SEC didn't look at it as funny. And 10 years later, you know, Johnny Carson got away with it all the time, and nobody said a word. But for those 10 years, you know, he suffered immensely under that. And but he remained a disc jockey. In fact, in King Street, South Carolina, they got a monument to him up there now. And, you know, he passed away with Lou Gehrig's disease several years ago. But that's how I got my interest in record collecting, was in 1953. He was in Korea. And I found his record collection in the back of my grandmother's house.
Wow.
And she bought me a BB gun. And 78 just was so much fun just throwing them in the air and just shooting them and breaking them. And, and he came home and saw what I was doing, and I tell you what, I didn't shoot another 78 record after that.
I bet you didn't.
But anyway, a lot of the records I've collected over the years have been from the artists, and some have signed them, like the Clint Eastwood thing. I've got a great autograph of that one, and, you know, a lot of different artists. I made sure they all signed everything. George Jones, Loretta Lynn, a lot of people, every album I ever got. I worked 3 years backstage at the Opry in the 80s.
Oh, boy.
And, you know, that was back when it was a lot of fun because you got to meet the real legend. I wouldn't even waste my time going to the Opry now. They'd have to pay me, you know, because it's just not the same. I predict in 5 years there's not going to be a Grand Ole Opry.
Really?
You're not going to find any of these artists going up there 67 dates a year for $300. None of these new artists are going to do that. And so it's just a matter of time, and they'll fold it down. That'll be the end of it. Because there won't be anybody alive from that era to get up there and perform.
Yeah. But
and probably one of the most interesting times I had at the Opry, and it's a story that goes way back, was when Garth Brooks appeared for the first time, and I had to get him settled down over in the corner stage. Wasn't nobody but myself and Garth. He didn't even have a record label yet. And it was his first time. He had bit his fingernails to the quick, and they were bleeding all over his guitar and everything. He says, "What do I do?" I said, "You just go out there and show them you love them, and they'll love you right back." And he got up there and sang his first song. That's all they allowed him. And he came back, sat down with me. He says, "Did I do okay? Did I do okay?" I said, "Well, you hear them, don't you? They liked you." And he asked me, he says, "Now, you've got a record label in South Carolina." He says, "Do you mind if I sign with your record label?" And I said, "Look, Garth," I said, "get out there and love those people. They'd love you right back, but you can't sing." And so we made it a joke every Christmas, and this Christmas I'll get another Christmas card from Garth, and he said, "Can I sing yet?" And I said, "No, you got goodness here." And we've been doing that for 30 years, back and forth. I've got a set of Christmas cards here from Garth Brooks. We just made a joke out of it. And, you know, I'll tell you something about Garth. A lot of people don't know how he became a superstar. His second single on Capitol Records was a song called Alabama Clay. I've got the 45. Nobody else, probably in the United States other than him, has a copy of it.
No way. Wow.
Most people threw it away, discarded it and everything. It was a total flop. It was the second song after Much Too Damn Old. And Capitol was ready to dump him.
Yeah.
And came along with the dance. And the rest was history. But his father was an old man out in Oklahoma. Capitol had pressed 20,000 LPs. His father bought all of the LPs and put them in a warehouse. Well, they said, "Well, what's going on here? You know, this guy's practically unknown." They pressed another 20,000. He bought all of those. Nobody in America owned a Garth Brooks album but his father, and I got one. And all of a sudden, he's plastered on the front of People magazine.
Uh-huh.
And He's the biggest, newest superstar out there, and nobody had an album.
Well, I think Garth Brooks was probably the biggest selling artist of the 90s. Is that correct?
Oh, now, and what happened was his father sold all of the LPs that he bought up back to the distributor.
Isn't that something?
And that by then, the dance was climbing very rapidly up the chart. And the rest was history after that.
Hmm.
But it was a very good way to promote somebody back then.
Oh, yeah. And his father had faith.
You wouldn't get away with it now because you don't press that many vinyl records. But back then, that was the way it was done. And, you know, Cashbox and Billboard had their own problems. There was Murder on Music Row there, which I wrote an 8-part series on Murder on Music Row. Because I wrote the actual correct story. The guy that was convicted of that really was innocent. And myself and some of the shareholders here, we were 2 weeks away from getting him out of jail when he died on us. And it was really sad because, you know, he had done all that time for something he didn't do.
Mm-hmm.
And the person that had done it, he was already deceased, so it wasn't going to matter much anyway. And we're going to put that whole story together. There's a couple of movie people looking at it right now to do the correct version of what actually happened with that Murder on Music Row series that A&E repeats all the time, but they got it all wrong.
Mm.
You know, I was there that night. I was with Kevin. The only reason I didn't get shot, I don't like fish. He wanted to go eat fish up at Fish and Chips, and I said, no, I'm going back to the motel room. My son and the dog's up there, I don't have time. And he called Sammy Sadler, and that's when it all happened.
No crawfish that night, huh?
No, but if I would have went with him, I would have been the other person in that car with him.
Oh, boy.
So there was some kind of fate that God had planned for me other than, you know, going out with Kevin that night.
Oh, we would hate to think you would have missed this show today.
Yeah, that
was God. A lot of people. We've got a lot of news footage and all that stuff from that time. And we do plan on doing it right Monday when the right producer comes along that wants to do it. You know, it'll be a major motion picture.
Sounds to me like it would be a great story, that's for sure.
And the other thing is, it's talking about some of the other things, like your hit parade. You can actually go to yourhitparade.com and actually watch the kinescopes up there that I own. You know, NBC in 1959 had a big bonfire and burned all the kinescopes except for 12.
No kidding.
And Snooky Lanson got them and gave them to me. And that's what's left, what you see up there.
We're down to 3 minutes on the show here, Handsome. Tell us, tell our listeners how they can access your information about Cashbox, you, all the stuff that you're promoting right now.
Well, all they got to do is go to CashboxMagazine.com.
Okay. Cool.
Up there, they can go to the top. They can click on Record World Roots Music. With Cashbox Canada is run by Sandy Graham, and she worked with RCA for 40 years.
I just saw that on the internet, Cashbox Canada.
And Leonard Cohen, she's got him on the cover this week. Leonard's girlfriend was my cousin. That was Suzanne Elrod, which the two kids, you know, they never got married, but Adam and his sister were cousins. And
I hope not kissing cousins.
It's been kind of a bad week for that.
Oh, no.
It's obvious to me that we have to get Bruce back on again because he has just begun to tell these stories.
Yes, he's got me on the edge of my seat. I wanted to hear more of what he was talking about.
Yeah, wait till he gets to Randy Travis and some of the others he has to
tell. Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah, I don't know whether I could get away with that on the air, though.
Jerry, tell our listeners.
I will tell you that what we do, you will notice there are artists on Cashbox up there that we call featured artists. We don't have time to go out and look for these people. They're up there by sheer luck. And we get that from a lady called Kit Bradley that's part of the Bradley family out of Nashville.
Oh, boy.
And when she finds somebody, she thinks it's so unique We have a cash box promotion team here that's independent of the magazine. And they charge a certain amount, nothing like Billboard does. And they reach these charts. They work their butts off over here to get them on those charts.
Bruce, I got to go. I'm out of time. Love having you on the show. Jerry, you have any idea who's going to be our guest next week?
I think there's a good chance we might have Paul Peterson back. He was great.
I like Paul Peterson.
I do want you to know that I have confirmed Donna Fargo for December 8th.
Absolutely fabulous. And DJ Fontana, and get Hal Blaine back on the show. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Viva ENT. We're live in Seattle. This is Johnny DiCapo. Thank you very much, Bruce, for being on our show. Jerry O, Dion Shaw, the big Eric CC Ryder. We'll dig you now. See you later, because you are a fine sweet potato. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Good afternoon.